start with Jesus every day, moment by moment in work and play. I'm a star in life and starting out right. Starting with Jesus, it is a delight. Starting with Jesus, day and night. Starting with Jesus, I'm starting out right.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Starting with Jesus, where we want to encourage you to start everything you do with Jesus. Today's story is a little bit of a sad story because it's about two people who made some really, really not good decisions, some sad choices. But I'm glad their story was included in the Bible. You know why? Because those stories help us to make good decisions, to make good choices. But before we get to that, we've got to get to some singing. Let's sing.
I've two little hands to work for Jesus, one little tongue his praise to tell, two little ears to hear his counsel, one little voice his song to swell. Lord, we come, Lord, we come, in our childhood's early morning. Lord, we come, Lord, we come, come to learn of thee. I've one little heart to give to Jesus, one little soul for him to save, one little life for his dear service, one little self that he must have. Lord, we come, Lord, we come, in our childhood's early morning. Lord, we come, Lord, we come, come to learn of thee.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead. Tell every foe he's vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey. Forth to the mighty conflict in this his glorious day. Ye that are men now saved against unnumbered foes, let courage rise with danger and strength to strength oppose. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss.
Hello, boys and girls, welcome to Sharing Time. I'm so glad you're here. We have a special sharing time today. We're here camping, and I'm gonna share a story with some of my friends and family here, and you can join in. So are you ready? Okay. So our story today is about a moose. Now, what are the things that can hurt moose or like get moose? What are some things that can get a moose?
Bears.
Maybe some mountain lions.
Wolves.
Okay. Lots of different animals can get moose. But moose, what do they have that can protect them? They have some horns, right? They're really strong. And they also kick with their feet, right?
Yes.
So they can take their feet and they can kick and they can take their horns and they can toss things. And not a lot of animals get
a moose because they're so big and they're so strong and they've got these pointy horns and these pointy toes. But if a moose maybe is what we would call compromised or isn't able to fight, then an animal might be able to get it, right? Well, today I'm gonna tell about a moose who something happened to. There was a lady who would always put out her extra fruit. So maybe she'd have some pears or some peaches or different things that had maybe they couldn't eat them. And so she would put them in the backyard and the moose would love to come and eat the fruit. And so he would come and nom, 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 nom. Well, one day something happened. The fruit that they got that day, well, the pears had gotten a little overripe. And when pears get a little overripe, something happens. They get fermented. And fermentation is what happens when you make alcohol. And what it does is the fruit becomes just a little rotten and a little bit fermented. And what it does is it affects your brain. Like alcohol, when you drink alcohol, it makes you not be able to think as well, right? It affects the way you think. Well, this moose, he got some of those pears. And boy, was he having some fun, because as he ate those pears, he started not being able to think as clearly. And he started to wobble a little bit, and he started to walk a little bit funny, but he didn't know what was going on. He thought he was having a great time. And as he's walking along, all of a sudden he found himself stuck. Do you know where he was stuck?
In mud.
No?
A tree.
He got stuck in a tree. And you say, well, how on earth could he get stuck in a tree, Miss Ruthie? Well, the tree had a big branch this way and a big branch this way. And it was just, those two branches were just barely above the ground. So while he was walking like this, his body went right into the tree. And he just kind of sat there like this. Now I've got a question. While he was stuck in the tree, could he really get away from a wolf? No. And if a mountain lion came and got him, do you think the mountain lion could get him? Yes, a lot easier, because what? He couldn't really fight them back, right? He was stuck. So he's stuck in that tree. He can't get out and he can't move, all because he had something in his body, some alcohol fermented pears that made it so that his brain made it so he couldn't think as clearly, and he got himself stuck. What was he gonna do? You know what? Even a house cat could come along and scratch him and couldn't get hurt because he was stuck. That's so silly. But you know what? That's what alcohol and things like that and drugs and other things do to our brains. They make it so we can't think clearly. Do we ever wanna put that stuff in our bodies?
No.
Do you know how they got that moose out of that tree? They had to take a tranquilizer gun, they had to tranquilize him, and they had to get him up and out of the tree so that he wouldn't get caught or hurt by any animals. All because he'd had some fermented pears. And so, boys and girls, let's be careful what we eat and what we drink and what we put in our bodies to make sure that we only put good things inside of our bodies, so that we can think clearly and we can act well and we can always know what to do and how to be like Jesus. So do you want today to commit to always put good things in your body?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
I am so glad. Okay, well, we'll see you later, and make sure to always be exploring God's nature.
It's time to access this week's Nature Spotlight to see a nature submission that one of you has turned in. Today's pictures were sent in by Mia and Analia. Location, North Carolina. Butterflies remind me of the transformation that we go through as Christians. Such a drastic change for the better. Aw, thank you, God, for keeping your promise to transform lives and changing us to become more and more like you each day. And thanks, girls, for sending this in. I encourage you to get out there and notice God's wonderful nature, the big and the small that God has designed especially for you. So grab a grown-up and go explore. And don't forget to take a picture, record a video, or make a drawing and send it to us at nature@startingwithjesus.com. I can't wait to see it!
Hey everyone, Miss Michelle here, and this week's lesson really got me thinking. It was a hard lesson for me to prepare to tell you guys because I really like happy stories, and this week's story is not so happy, but it teaches us a really important lesson. So let's ask Jesus to be with us as we explore his word. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love for us, for always being with us and for loving us no matter what. I pray that you would be with us now. Send your Holy Spirit to be here just like you sent your Spirit to be with the children of Israel in the wilderness. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, so we've been talking so much about the sanctuary, haven't we? Everything in the sanctuary pointed to, you said it, Jesus. And today we're going to learn a little bit more about what God is like, because his people were very organized in their wilderness adventure. In fact, they were divided into 12 large groups. You may have heard of them before, right? The 12 tribes. And each of those tribes had a specific place where they were to set up their camp. The tents were in straight rows, and they were all facing towards the sanctuary. You could really tell what was important, couldn't you? There were 3 tribes on the east, 3 on the south, 3 on the west, and 3 on the north. And each tribe had a special flag or a standard that showed where their tribe was camping. These tribes were after Jacob's 12 sons. That's where the names for the groups came from. And those families made up those different groups. Now, you may find it curious, if you study it closely, to find that there is no tribe of Levi mentioned in the 12 tribes in the wilderness, and there's no tribe of Joseph. Why is that? I'm glad you asked, and this is super important to remember. The Levites were very loyal to God, and God honored this tribe, or this group, this family, and gave them the special job of caring for the sanctuary. They were the priests, and they moved and cared for the sanctuary and took care of things there. So they were not listed as one of the 12 official tribes, because they were kind of like the pastors of their day. So they were in a separate group altogether. And then Joseph, so that would leave us to 11 tribes, right? So Joseph, his tribe was not actually named after him. It was named after his 2 sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. So that's where all of the 12 tribes come from that you'll see in the Bible. All right, so you have that. The Levite family were the priests. And Aaron, Moses was of the Levite tribe, or I should keep saying tribe, of the Levite family, right? And his brother Aaron was chosen by God to be the high priest. And the high priest was a very important role, right? They were the only ones who were allowed to go into the most holy place once a year, right? And so it was really important. And they had really special robes too. You can study about this a lot, but some of the very special things about it were on the headband, it said, "Holiness to the Lord" here. He had a special breastplate that had 12 stones, one for each of the tribes of Israel. He had really important stones here they had funny names. Let me make sure I'm saying it right. The Urim and the Thummim, and I might be, because I don't speak Hebrew, so that might not be correct, but that's my best guess. And they would glow. Well, this is so awesome, because it was one way that God communicated with the Israelites. The right one glowed if the answer was yes to the question that the high priest brought before the Lord, and the left one got cloudy if the answer was no. Isn't that amazing? How, it was very sure what God was saying to them, wasn't it? And there was a special ceremony then, after the sanctuary was finished, the tabernacle of the Lord was finished, there was a special ceremony where the priests were anointed, and the sanctuary was anointed and was dedicated with sacrifices and all sorts of, you can read about it in the Bible, we don't have time to go into all the details of this special celebration. It was so amazing, special oil and all sorts of ceremonies were performed, and this was a really big deal, and the priests knew that they had a really special job. And they were given really specific rules for how God wanted them to do that, because doing it just the way God said pointed to Jesus. That's important, isn't it? It's always important to look to Jesus. Now, there was something really sad that happened. I don't know if you heard about this, but Nadab and Abihu died the other day in the temple, way back when, right? why would they have died in the temple of God? This is so strange, right? Let's find out what happened in God's word. Leviticus 10 verse 1 is where we're going to start out with. How could this have happened? This is the really sad part of the story. I'm going to tell you right now. It says, then Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, each took his censer and put fire in it, put incense in it, and offered, and this is the bad part, profane fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. Now, back up. What's a censer, Miss Michelle? Well, I'm glad you asked. A censer is what this priest is holding here, and the regular priest could hold it too. It was like a metal bowl, and then it had chains on it, and they would put coals from the altar of incense in there, and they would put, so it would be sweet smelling. Incense, it's like a spice, it's like a stick of spice or so. And it just smells beautiful. And that represented the prayers going up to heaven to Jesus, right? And that we could speak to Jesus about our problems, right? That he is the answer, that he solves our problems, that we should look to him, right? But they didn't get fire and coals from that altar inside the holy place like they were supposed to. They got profane fire. I would say any bonfire back then was what they would have called profane fire. So we had a bonfire the other day. If I would have taken coals, like the remnants, the hot parts of the parts that glow in the bottom of a fire, right? And the coals from one of my bonfires, that would be profane fire because it's not holy fire or holy coals from that specific altar that God had directed them to do. So they were not following what God said. And it's like, okay, they weren't following directions. Yes, but these directions were to teach the whole Israelite nation about Jesus. So really they were going directly against what God said. And that messed up the symbolism of what he was trying to teach his people. They were not pointing to Jesus. They were pointing to themselves instead. Let's find out what happened next. He had not commanded them to do this, right? So fire went out from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. Wow. What a consequence. Now, they were leaders of the nation, weren't they? Everyone looked to the Levites and would follow what they did. And so when God saw them disobeying, right after he'd told them very specific directions of what to do, they had chosen to not be on his team anymore, hadn't they? They had chosen to point people away from Jesus. And that's what Satan wants to do, doesn't he? He wants to point people away from Jesus. And that was their consequence. Wow. How sad that they made that horrible choice. They could have made such a better choice, couldn't they have, if they had followed God's directions? And you can just imagine the sorrow that Aaron had as well. Do you know why they did that? Well, it was their choice, but they also made a very unwise choice directly before then. You know what they had chosen? Your memory verse this week tells you a big hint. Don't drink wine or intoxicating drink. Leviticus 10, verse 9. They had done that. They were not thinking clearly, were they? And they suffered a huge consequence for their actions. Let's be careful what we put in our bodies and always, always follow God and his rules for our life, because they will keep us happy and safe. Thanks so much for listening. And until next time, remember to start with Jesus by exploring his word.
Hi, welcome to Craft Time. I'm so excited to see you today. Well, I decided it'd be cool to make a censer, a prayer censer. So, the first thing you'll need is paper. Construction paper works best. If you don't have that, you can do cardstock or just regular paper. And then you'll need a hole puncher to punch a hole, some tape, some string. I'm just using thread because that's what I had on hand, but yarn or string will also work. Some scissors. And a pencil or a pen to trace your hands. So, the first thing you're going to need to get started is you're going to need to fold your paper. And then you're going to need to take your pen and put your hand down on your paper. Make sure your thumb is on the folded side like that. And then you're going to trace your hands with your pencil or your pen. And you might want somebody else to help you with this. I'm just going to try it on my own, so you can ask your parents or whoever is going to help you with this craft to do that. And then you're going to take your scissors, and you're going to want to make sure your parents are okay with you cutting by yourself, and otherwise you're going to want them to help you with this part. And then you're going to cut your hand out. And make sure not to cut the folded line. So cut around it, but don't cut the folded line. The next step is to tape. You're gonna want to make sure that you leave the top not taped, but around halfway down, you're gonna want to start taping this, so. And then you're going to take your hole punch and you're going to hole punch it right at your third finger. So one, two, three, your thumb, one, two, three, right there. Hole punch both sides. There we go. So you're gonna take your string or your thread or whatever you're using, your yarn, and you're gonna tie it to both sides. One side of the string to one side of the hand and the other side of the string to the other side of the hand. There we go. I'm gonna trim that. And there I have my prayer center. Now the last thing you can do if you want is you can insert some little card fire. So remember the fire represented the Holy Spirit. So if you want, you can cut out of your excess paper, it looks really funny. Some little squares. And then on them, you can write different verses of the Holy Spirit. And you can just write the verses, or you can write where they're found, or you can write both. And stick them, once you're done, into your prayer censer, like that. And whenever I want to find a verse of the Holy Spirit, I can go in there and I can see. And I can look it up in my Bible, 1 Corinthians 3:16. And whenever I see my prayer censer, I'm gonna be reminded of Nadab and Abihu. And I'm going to be reminded that I should never be rebellious like they were. So I hope you have fun making your craft. Bye!
Thank you, Miss Amy, for that craft, and Miss Michelle for our Bible story. Now it's time to review last week's questions to see what they were and to see if you got them right. It's time now for our new questions. Are you ready? Okay, question number one. Which tribe was faithful to God and took care of his sanctuary? Which tribe was faithful to God and took care of his sanctuary? Question number two. Who was the high priest? Who was the high priest? And question number three. Why did Nadab and Abihu receive such a serious consequence? Why did Nadab and Abihu receive such a serious consequence? Now, where can you send those answers to? That's right, answers@startingwithjesus.com.
Leviticus 10 verse 9 says, "Do not drink wine nor strong drink."
You may have heard that alcohol is bad for your brain. But what does that mean? Well, your brain is the control center for the rest of your body. Your brain processes information and manages all the vital involuntary actions like breathing and keeping a regular heartbeat. Your brain makes it possible for you to run, to play, to learn things, to feel emotions, to do all of these things. Your brain contains many different parts. Your brain transfers information throughout your whole body with nerve cells called neurons. These are chemical messengers called neurotransmitters. We're going to use these as an example of neurotransmitters. They carefully move information from one neuron to the next. Now, neurotransmitters can either be excitatory, they stimulate brain activity, I'll put that one in, or they can be inhibitory, the blue ones we're using as an example, and these ones slow down brain activity. Now, the brain tries to keep a careful balance between these two types of neurotransmitters. Balance in your brain, excitatory, inhibitory, excitatory, inhibitory, and they keep a good balance. Now, alcohol boosts certain chemicals in the brain's reward system. Specifically, alcohol boosts inhibitory brain neurotransmitters. So, you get more slowing down of your brain activity. It also decreases your brain's ability to stimulate brain activity. So you get less of the excitatory neurotransmitters. Before you know it, what happens? Oh, your brain function has completely gotten out of balance, huh? Well, with all this slowed down brain function, sometimes you might lose your balance, or you could start to forget things. You might get angry or really sad for no reason at all. And it's just because alcohol has caused your brain to not be able to balance all the jobs that it's supposed to be doing. Basically, as alcohol hits the different parts of your brain, it makes it hard for them to do their jobs properly. And remember, what important things does your brain control? It helps control the most important things like breathing and your heartbeat. And too much alcohol can affect those things as well. Now, most of the time, the effects of alcohol can wear off in a rather short period of time, but repeated use of alcohol can have some long-term effects too. You know, in our story this week, we saw some men who were under the influence of alcohol, and they made some poor decisions because their brain was out of balance. They weren't able to make the best decision for themselves. Now, if you want more information about alcohol and how it affects your body, ask a trusted adult. Knowing the facts can keep you healthy and help you make healthy decisions.
Thank you so much for watching. I'm so glad you were here. If you're at ASI right now, make sure to come and check out our booth. Now, let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much that you love us. Thank you that you are so good to us. Help us to make good choices. Help us to learn from the mistakes of others, and help us to always strive to do what you would want us to do. We love you, Jesus, and we thank you for your love to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for watching. Have a blessed week, and keep in touch.